I want you to think of narcissistic traits on a spectrum, right? So this spectrum can go from like very low level, not harmful to yourself or others, but it's just there, to very intense, harmful, abusive, right? Again, all of that, even on this end, doesn't mean the person has narcissistic personality disorder. So we're going to look at these traits on a spectrum, right? And we're going to talk about where they show up and who we see them with. So the biggest thing here is that narcissistic traits are very common among abusive people, toxic people, and emotionally immature people. I love Dr. Gibson's teachings on emotionally immature people and like parents and like children that have survived that, because so many of us have been labeling all these people as narcissistic, right? I see it all the time. My mom's a narc, my dad's a narc, right? When really what we're talking about is maybe somebody who's emotionally immature, maybe abusive or maybe toxic, that has narcissistic traits, right? So that's what we're going to look at, because we can be very wounded and hurt by narcissistic traits without encountering a narcissist, right? This is really common for people with childhood trauma. So people with narcissistic traits that fall under the sort of umbrella of maybe emotionally immature, toxic, or abusive, almost always have had childhood trauma or have unresolved trauma in some way. And so this is where we do see a lot of really good people. I work with clients all the time who have severe childhood trauma, who are good people that have narcissistic traits. And they're like terrified. They'll be like, oh my gosh, am I a narcissist? No, their childhood and the environment they're in sort of birthed some of these traits, right? So you can have some of these traits and be a great person. I know a lot of people have this big fear that if you have narcissistic traits, you can't change or heal, because there's a lot of talk about how narcissists can't change. But again, we're separating NPD and narcissistic traits. And one of the main ways in which we separate this, the biggest difference that I see between someone who has something like narcissistic personality disorder and somebody with narcissistic traits, are the motives. The motives with which somebody does something. That's sort of one of the delineating factors that I use to examine which side of the line somebody falls on with this, right? Because with NPD, with narcissistic personality disorder, it is all about the self, right? It's all about them and what serves them. Whereas an emotionally immature or toxic person, they just might be very impulsive or unaware. They tend to lack a lot of awareness, or really reactive, unintentionally reactive, sort of like a child, right? They can often, like, a lot of parents will tell me that they are scared that they think that their child's a narcissist, because children are extremely selfish and they're extremely self-focused. And in the beginning, they do have these really big egos, right? They think they're Superman or Batman or something special, right? So people will be like, oh, I'm so scared that my kid's a narcissist. That's natural to childhood, which is why we don't look at narcissism in childhood. But as we've talked before about stages of development and trauma and how it impacts them, you can understand how if you are experiencing trauma in your childhood that keeps you from developing out of those stages into adulthood, you're going to end up an adult who is emotionally immature, maybe abusive, that acts very much like a child and still has some of those narcissistic traits that you would see in a child, right? But it becomes much more dangerous at those ages once we're in adulthood. So we're looking at the motives, right? Narcissist is very much about themselves, whereas an emotionally mature, toxic person can be really impulsive, maybe isn't aware of what they're doing, really reactive. And it's kind of like a Venn diagram, right? There's some crossover between there, but here is an example to try to help you see the difference. Let's say that a person with narcissistic personality disorder, right, they are somewhat delusional. That's why we call it delusions of grandeur, about themselves. So let's say that somebody triggers them and triggers their insecurity, and so they assault that person. They get into a bar fight or something like that. A person with NPD, somebody with narcissistic personality disorder, is going to think that they shouldn't get in trouble or have any consequences because they're above the law. They're special, right? It just doesn't apply to them. They're different. Whereas, let's take the exact same scenario and take an emotionally immature person with narcissistic traits. They get triggered and they lash out impulsively and reactively and they assault somebody. And they also don't think they should get in trouble, but they're coming from a stance of, because it's not my fault, they started it, they were mean first, sort of like a childish temper tantrum, right? We see the same level of denial and the same request for different treatment, but the motive is different, right? Narcissists have a level of delusion that makes it so that, like, they can't even see an alternative, right? There's some, I was going to do the research on this beforehand. I didn't have time, but I've read a couple things in the past that shows that, like, people with NPD have, not all, but some have, like, brain damage, presumably from trauma, that alters their ability to see things or develop the ability to see things in a different way, which is not always true of somebody who's, like, emotionally immature, who's got a narcissistic trait, right? And that lends itself to talking about getting help. So another thing that sort of separates the two, a lot of people have heard this, that narcissists don't change or they can't change. But in truth, people with NPD don't generally get better because they don't seek help to begin with, because they don't think that there's anything wrong with them, right? And because they tend to strategically place themselves around people or in relationships that support those delusions, they never are really confronted with an opportunity to contemplate if they need help or not. We see that happen when they bump into the law, or they get in trouble, or maybe they get fired for the umpteenth time, or somebody leaves them. But often the perspective is, well, then how do I just fix this, right? So they don't often seek help. And when they do, again, their motive isn't self-reflective and self-aware. It's much more like, this made me look bad. How do I change that? Or how do I fix this to get what I want? So we do see them come into therapy at times, but a well-trained therapist will most often quickly identify that there's an ulterior motive that's going on. And narcissists, people with narcissistic personality disorder, can often malign therapy, meaning that they will use the therapist to try to perpetuate their narrative, or to use them as a tool to try to control or hurt or push down others, which is, you know, challenging when you've got somebody who's maybe intelligent and charming and learns what we call therapy speak, then going out and telling people, my therapist said, you're the problem, right? Therapists are supposed to be trained in how to identify this because it can cause a lot of damage. But when they do come to therapy, they often don't last long because once a therapist does catch on, things change. Whereas somebody who has narcissistic traits, right? Maybe they're emotionally immature, abusive, or toxic, or maybe they just have narcissistic traits from unhealed trauma. They are more likely to seek help and they are more likely to see change, right? Those narcissistic traits can decrease over time as they become more emotionally mature, as they increase their self-awareness, as they increase their self-compassion, right? They heal that self-esteem, self-confidence. There's more self-love there. So we do see change on that side of things. I'm always really careful with that because people tend to draw this line of saying, these people are never going to change. There's no hope for them. When we don't want to lump everybody into one category, right? Because I worked with lots of people who have had very toxic narcissistic traits, but have healed them through doing the work, right? It does take time and there can be hurdles, but that's the difference. Right? It's not the narcissist can't heal or grow or change. It's that they often don't even seek it because they don't think anything's wrong. Or somebody with narcissistic traits, often when consequences from those traits happen, we'll seek help and are open to changing and growing. As you can imagine, it's just a tough pill to swallow, right? If anybody's ever been in therapy or done treatment like that, or even in some of these sessions that we do where we chat on stuff, it's like looking in a mirror, and sometimes that's a hard look, right? And it can take us some time to accept and process what we're seeing. So some things to know about narcissism in general, right? So traits, this is the focus mainly on the traits, but this also can be said of people with narcissistic personality disorder. Like I said, narcissism in general is created within childhood, right? There are specific childhood ingredients that lend itself toward the development of somebody with narcissism. And that typically is an environment where the parents are largely emotionally absent, but put a really strong emphasis on things like performance, appearance, status, and material things. If you ever saw the show 13 Reasons Why, Bruce Walker is a really great example of this. He's got a very wealthy family. It's all about how they look. His worth as their son is based off of his achievements and his status. They spend little to no time with him. There's no connection, no secure attachment, but they throw money at him like crazy. And he is a really great example of a narcissism or a narcissist in that show, right? Somebody who displays a lot of narcissistic tendencies. So that's sort of the ingredients that we see. There can be abuse in it as well, but not necessarily. And that's where we see a spectrum, right? This is also why we see so many narcissistic tendencies among wealthy people or even famous people, right? Not always, not categorizing, but because that is the culture in some of those ways, status and affluence and presentation, and there's not a lot of safety for things like personal development because you can't be flawed, we start to create this persona of a very insecure, damaged, underdeveloped person internally, and this overly proud, arrogant, haughty, entitled person on the outside, right? That's sort of how that starts to happen. And like I said, some of those people can be well-intentioned, good people that never harm a fly, but live that sort of double life in that way. The interesting thing here, as speaking of childhood and sort of the environments, is that the environment that births empathetic people and the environment that births narcissists are often very similar. And we tend to see a pattern of those empathetic people and those narcissistic people finding each other later in life. And we're going to talk more about that in part two, but because they tend to come from somewhat similar environments. Now, the difference between whether a person goes left or right and becomes like a highly empathetic sort of people-pleasing trauma response fawner and somebody who becomes more narcissistic can be a million different things. But some of the things that we see is that if a person has at least one secure attachment, one safe person, one good role model where they're helping them develop empathy and giving them space to develop their character, we tend to see them go left into the empathetic side. If they don't have that, they might go right, right? But also things like birth order or gender, family dynamics, socioeconomic status all can play a role. I worked with a lot of people who are deeply, deeply empathetic fawners, people pleasers, that have some narcissistic traits that are super confused. And understanding that like the same environment can sort of create both, it can go either way, can be helpful if that's something that you feel that you struggle with. We talked about how narcissists lack empathy. But I want to be really clear that empathy is not an inherent trait. It is not something that you're born with or born without. Like a narcissist, you're not doomed to be a narcissist because empathy is a skill that is taught and honed, right? So if you are not given empathy as a child, if it's not modeled for you, if it's not a part of the family culture, you're simply not going to develop it, right? That doesn't mean that you can't. Again, a lot of people out there with narcissistic traits from their childhood environments have reparented themselves and grown the muscle, developed the skill of empathy in their adult life, right? Maybe before they developed it and they lacked it, they might have been more cruel or more harsh or maybe more abusive or a bad friend or whatever. But then they can intentionally develop that. Again, the difference between somebody with a narcissistic trait and a narcissist is that they're likely to seek, some of the narcissistic traits are more likely to seek help and be open to being honest about this, to grow it, whereas a narcissist doesn't see a problem with it, right? So we are very quick to judge narcissistic people for the lack of empathy. Or if you are somebody that, if you're being honest with yourself, recognize that you struggle with empathy, we want to remove that judgment because we can't change what we judge, and to recognize that even if you had well-meaning parents or even if it was something that was important, if you were in survival mode for a portion of your life, whether it was in childhood or elsewhere, there's not really any room for empathy when you're in survival mode. If you wake up in the middle of the night and your neighbor's house is on fire, you're going to go help, right? If you wake up in the middle of the night and your house is on fire and your neighbor's house is on fire, you're going to focus on your house first. If that is your repeated experience over and over and over again, you don't have the opportunity to develop empathy. And because narcissists tend to be born of very traumatic sort of childhood environments, their house is always on fire. So they don't develop that empathy. Right. A lot of well-meaning people relate to this struggle. And I just want to encourage you that you can still develop empathy. It's a skill that you can create. It doesn't mean that you're a narcissist. And lacking empathy can give you more narcissistic traits because you're more self-focused. You're unable to consider others. But think of that as like the residual aftermath of a wound that you have. Once you heal that wound up, you'll see that change. A lot of people talk about the difference between covert and overt narcissists, but if you look at the definition and sort of the criteria, it kind of lends itself toward almost all narcissistic people, people with NPD, are covert in nature. Because they care so much about reputation and appearance, they aren't overtly abusive. Maybe behind closed doors they are, but they're not going to be like that overtly because they care so much about ego. So if you know somebody that you would associate as narcissistic, but they're very overtly abusive, you're more likely dealing with somebody that maybe is emotionally mature, toxic, or abusive, that has narcissistic traits, than somebody with NPD. So those aren't official terms that are included yet or that we use, but I separate the two to help people sort of distinguish between who they're dealing with, because there's a very big difference between dealing with somebody who's emotionally mature with narcissistic traits and somebody with NPD. And that covert overt thing can be a way of sort of separating that out. I'm sure a lot of you have heard terms like smear campaign or love bombing or flying monkeys or blame shifting or like abuse amnesia. These are not official clinical terms, but this is language that we've sort of adopted to help us understand toxic behavior that can be displayed by narcissists or by just abusive people in general. And I say that because we have a lot of people out there who are getting the label of narcissist and then all these other label follows. And then other people out there who we understand aren't narcissists who are doing some of these things, who have flying monkeys, who have abuse amnesia, right? Flying monkeys are people that a toxic person has sort of manipulated to support them unabashedly without question to do their bidding. It comes from the Wizard of Oz, right? Where the green witch sends out her flying monkeys to like do her dirty work. That's the term where it comes from. And there's a lot of people that are experiencing a lot of abuse and damage from flying monkeys of people that are abusive, but they're not recognizing what's going on because we're only attributing it to narcissism. Right, so we want to be careful with that language and recognize that these are just this is language we've developed to just discuss toxic, abusive behavior and people in general. Whether or not it's strictly attributed to narcissism or not is sort of yet to be seen. So we want to be careful of labels. We do want to learn the language. A lot of people think that narcissists are just really mean, abusive people, and they completely miss that the main focus is these delusions of grandeur. Right? And when we don't learn that language, when we don't understand what that means, we can often miss it. I've had a lot of clients who have a favorite uncle or a person in their life that they really love, that they think is fantastic. And when they learn this language, they start to see them through a different light, recognizing that a well-meaning relative that you love and care about might have some of these traits. And we learn that stuff, not so that we can cut these people off or attack them or whatnot, but because awareness is so important, right? Having awareness of basically what people's wounds are and how they've chosen or learned to handle them is a huge step in something like protecting ourselves, right? But that's for next session. So in part two, we're going to look at how to heal and deal with narcissism and narcissistic traits, as well as sort of protective factors that you can develop or incorporate to protect you from any future abuse. Because unfortunately, if you have been a victim of narcissistic abuse, it almost sort of marks you, and other narcissistic people tend to sniff you out because of the dynamics that it creates. So one of the things that I'm super dedicated to in my professional world is helping victims of narcissistic abuse, whether that's by somebody with NPD or just narcissistic traits by a toxic person, not only heal up, but sort of learn how to equip themselves with knowledge and understanding and these protective factors so that they're not victims in the future. And if you've ever encountered or been the victim of or dealt with a narcissist and learned that that's what was happening, that they were a narc, once that's happened once, you sort of can spot them in the future. One of the biggest issues that we still have in our society is that we don't recognize them. And some of the narcissistic traits out there are even praised or admired by society. And so we have a lot of people who've been victims of narcissistic abuse who aren't believed because we struggle, if you are sort of a normally developed, I say that with quotes, person who has empathy, who has some understanding, we struggle to understand the mindset of a narcissistic person. And we tend to project our own humanity onto them and think, oh no, it must be something else. They must have not meant it. And that causes a lot of victims to stay stuck in cycles and continue to be abused. So it's really important that we educate ourselves on this and talk about it without judging or mislabeling, so that we can heal anything within us that maybe is on that narcissistic trait spectrum, and then learn how to identify people that maybe have some of these struggles, and then how to protect ourselves against that. So that's going to be part two.